Officer of the National Capital Commission. Je m'appelle Mark Christmensen. Je suis premier dirigeant de la Commission de la Capitale Nationale. Welcome. Bienvenue à la dernière conférence de la série de labos d'urbanisme de la Commission de la Capitale Nationale de cette année, marquant dans l'histoire de notre pays. I'm just wondering how many of you here have participated in the NCC's Urbanism Lab events. Okay, good number, maybe a half to a third to a half, so that's good. Well, keep coming, and we certainly invite everyone to come. It's at our building at 40 Elgin Street, and essentially running events every month, and if you want to talk to Stan Linewand, who you'll meet in a few minutes, he can fill you in more. So thank you all for joining us all tonight, and also I'd like to welcome everyone watching on the live stream. And before I begin, I'd like to once again thank the Azrieli School of Architecture and Urbanism at Carleton University for partnering with us to present tonight's speakers. Fostering design excellence in the capital is a significant priority for the NCC. I'd like to thank Professor Jill Stoner and also Professor Bonnier and Professor Fai for their continued partnership. I guess 3 years ago, we presented Daniel Libeskind here on this stage together as we were completing the National Holocaust Monument, which is now complete, and certainly invite everyone to come and see what I think is a wonderful realization. The year after, we had Morton Schmidt. Nous avons le coup d'envoi avec la conférence de Monsieur Schmidt, qui a dirigé une bonne discussion sur l'excellence en design, en particulier sur les espaces publics, comme son concept primé de la nouvelle bibliothèque publique d'Halifax. And I know he's gone on to do some work in China and New Zealand since we last saw him. So Morton Schmidt was a great talk. So I know that tonight's lecture on the application of cutting-edge imaging to urban planning, design, and policy making will be equally memorable. Since the advent of perspective drawing in the Renaissance, the rendering of views has been a vital part of urban planning and architecture. And today, the type of visualizations that are possible, the level of detail, the range of possibility, would seem like sorcery to Renaissance thinkers. But it's here, and it's real, very interesting, and we'll be exploring that tonight. Mais maintenant, la réalité virtuelle nous permet de voir les projets tels qu'on les imagine et rend possible des outils qui nous permettent de concevoir les environnements que nous entourent. At the NCC, we're accumulating big data. We're accumulating the kind of data that will find its way into the kind of visualizations that we're talking tonight. And we're having interesting internal discussions, and I'd like to thank our panelists for coming in today for a workshop with our staff. And I was at a conference in Edinburgh last week where they were talking about applying artificial intelligence in this Microsoft program for land use. It was just remarkable to see where these things are going. So this is a very timely session to have for us, and we're very, very happy to work with Carleton on this. We also have here Michel Biagé, who's the director of IT for the NCC, and he's leading the development of a 3D model for the capital. Bob Alsop is here, who we've been having discussions with, who pioneered the views protections that we rely on in the capital, and there's going to be a meeting next week to advance this. So this is really just wonderful to have this session tonight with our three panelists to start exploring this and get our heads deeply into this very interesting field. Before I introduce our next speaker, I'm just going to close with the thought that we probably are, with respect to these emerging technologies of visualization, big data, and artificial intelligence, probably where the people were with linear perspective 400 years ago. And there will be wonderful outcomes and probably less than wonderful outcomes as we explore these things. But I think having the event tonight and having these experts come and speak is a wonderful way to get us into it. So avec ça, je vais terminer mes commentaires. Je veux introduire Madame Bonnier, Professeur Bonnier, vient ici pour commencer la discussion ce soir. Et thank you all again for coming. It's great to see a full house here. And again, welcome to everyone watching online. Thank you so much. Merci beaucoup.
Good evening, welcome, and thank you for joining us here. I'm Catherine Bonnier, a faculty member at the Azrieli School of Architecture and Urbanism, and fortunate to have been one of the organizers of the Forum Lecture Series for this year. This is the third in our series, and I hope you'll consider joining us January 22nd back at the gallery. We'll be hosting an alumni panel in honor of the school's 50th anniversary, which is 2018. So what I would like to do is first extend a lot of gratitude in putting together an event like this. First of all, there is the gallery itself. We appreciate the gallery's ongoing support of the Forum Lecture Series. In addition, we have an ongoing thanks to the Forum founding sponsors who had the foresight to set up this lecture series, to which we always welcome professional students as well as the public. For tonight's event, we have been especially lucky and honored to partner with the NCC and the NCC Urbanism Lab in particular. We are always striving to reinforce the bonds between research and practice, moving into between school and city, and between the capital region and the world beyond. So the special thanks goes to Dr. Christmanson, also to Stan Leinwand, and to their excellent team, including Emily Girard-Ruel and Mamadou Kanté, for helping us stage tonight's event. In thinking about this topic and speaking to Stan Leinwand of the Urbanism Lab in advance, at the school, at the Azrieli School, working in preservation, architecture, and urbanism, our students work digitally. And as you know, often students are more advanced. So they're exploring 3D modeling, digital drawing, GIS, animation, 3D fabrication, photogrammetry, virtual reality. And with each year of technological evolution, we find there are new opportunities, new types of visualizations that maybe unlock new ideas as far as architecture and urbanism. But there are also very new challenges and questions that are sometimes problematic and really call for us to advance our profession as well as our pedagogy. So in thinking about the three speakers for tonight, we were looking for people who would really help us to advance those questions and those potentials when looking at digital visualization, and considered them for the diversity of their approaches, a number of scales, a number of techniques, as you'll see. Their full biographies, they're all very accomplished individuals, their full biographies are on the Azrieli School website. But what I'd like to do is introduce the three of them to you just briefly now. Our first speaker is Emma Greer. She is a Canadian architect with international experience as a project manager, strategic design consultant, public speaker, and lecturer. With an academic background in architectural history, urban studies, and housing, and an expertise acquired in the field across Europe and North America, Emma is a multidisciplinary professional whose work bridges between technology, design, and urban issues. As chief of staff at Carlo Ratti Associati in Torino, in Turin, Italy, Emma oversees the CRA cabinet, which is the executive branch of the office, responsible for external relations and for advancing the public image of the office. As a project manager at Ratti Associati, Emma provides general creative input on all ongoing work and leads projects focused on urban design, as well as retail and climate remediation. Our second speaker will be Fadi Massoud, who's joining us from Toronto. He is an assistant professor of landscape architecture and urbanism at the Daniels Faculty at University of Toronto. Fadi holds professional degrees in planning and in landscape architecture from the University of Waterloo, the University of Toronto, and Harvard University. He has previously taught at both Harvard and MIT, and his current research and design work focuses on establishing relationships between dynamic large-scale environmental systems, design, and the instrumentality of planning frameworks, policies, and codes. He's working on developing an interactive regulatory planning tool that will provide policymakers with a dynamic framework database of what he calls flex-based landscape coding strategies and land use regimes for more resilient and adaptable urban fabrics. Fadi has also designed several projects dealing with the future of suburbia, as well as urbanism in arid climates, along borderlines, and on coastal reclaimed lands. Our final speaker is Stephen Fai. Stephen Fai, many of you know, but he is the director of the Carleton Immersive Media Studio, or SIMS, and he's an associate professor at Carleton University. At SIMS, he works with students and others to question and develop digital workflows for the architecture, engineering, construction, and operations industry. His research integrates digitization, building information modeling, simulation, digitally assisted storytelling, and digitally assisted fabrication. Professor Fai holds a cross appointment with the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering, the Institute for Comparative Studies in Literature, Art, and Culture, and the Azrieli School of Architecture and Urbanism. He is also a faculty member in Carleton's Human-Computer Interaction and Digital Humanities programs. So we are delighted to welcome these accomplished speakers to take on the topic of imaging the city. Please join me now in welcoming Emma Greer.
Thanks, Katie, for the great introduction, and to Carleton and the NCC's Capital Urbanism Lab for putting on this phenomenal lecture series. Methods of representation are really central to the way that we understand the built environment, and therefore they shape the outcome of the design process. And I'm going to talk a little bit about our design process in a minute. But first, I'd like to give a little bit of background on myself and the team that I work with. If I can go to the next slide, please. There we go. So my background is in architecture and in urban design, but I wear a few different hats at Carlo Ratti Associati. I'm a partner and I work on projects from the scale of the city to the spoon, as Le Corbusier would have said. We really work on every scale from city master planning to architecture, urban design, exhibition, interiors, and furniture, with the common thread being technology and digital tools. I also head what we've nicknamed the CRA cabinet, which is the branch of the studio which manages, designs, and coordinates the public image of the office that is involved in all the projects that we do. We come to speak at lectures such as this. We coordinate the communication of the office, and we put on exhibitions. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Okay. So our practice belongs to a larger constellation of research, design, and startups, all headed by our creative director by the name of Carlo Ratti. The NCC actually got in touch with us through MIT's Sensible City Lab, which, amongst other things, studies the impact of new technology on the study of the built environment. When those ideas, often ideas coming from the lab, then become a design project, that's where our firm in Italy, and most recently in New York, very exciting news, we're opening a New York office, starts to come into the mix, where it becomes architecture, where we start to see the merging of the digital and the physical. From the work that we've done at our office in Turin and at the lab at MIT, based in Boston and Singapore, a number of ideas have spun off into startups. So we've got Maker Shaker, the makers of the robotic bartending system, and Super Pedestrian, makers of the Copenhagen wheel. And across all of these branches, we use imagery and representation at the center of our process. We'll take a look at a couple of different examples. There we go. Green button pointed here. We use a process that we like to call future crafting, which is really extrapolating from a present condition and putting ourselves as designers in one or several possible future scenarios. And what makes this different for us than prediction or forecasting is we really try to put the message out there, put those possible questions or futures out there, and get feedback through social media, through public participation, seminars, through lectures such as this, to really get people's feedbacks on what this future city or city of tomorrow could look like. So it basically has three steps. First, we analyze the present condition, we represent, we image what exists today. Then we prepare future scenarios and we phrase them as what if questions. And then lastly, and most importantly, is we disseminate those images, those representations of possible futures, and get feedback from the crowd. So I'd like to show you a few different projects that look at the different steps of this future crafting process, the first being the study of the status quo, of the existing scenario. As architects and city planners, we're really trained to study what exists and to represent it. The methods that we use to do this, how we choose to represent, as Peter Bosselman in Representations of Place wrote, really influences our view of reality and very significantly defines the outcomes of designs and plans, and therefore of our cities. With the increasing deployment of handheld sensors and electronics, a new approach to studying the status quo and the built environment is emerging. One statistic has said that from the dawn of civilization until 2003, we're producing that amount of data every couple of days. And that's a figure that's already a few years old. So this, of course, is the realm of big data. And this has allowed us to create visualizations of the city such as this. This was a visualization produced by Pedro Cruz from MIT Sensible City Lab using data from taxi networks in Lisbon. And here we see the city really as a living, changing organism, something that wasn't possible even a few years ago. How this was done exactly is each taxi has a unique taxi ID number, and that was tied to the velocities and the GPS of the different taxis, and that was studied over a month and then condensed into a typical day. The different colors represent slow-moving traffic in warm tones, and then the blue-green cooler tones represent faster flows of traffic. Here's another visualization of the use of big data to measure city dynamics. Normal or traditional methods of studying city dynamics might include something like a census survey or vehicle counting, something that is quite cumbersome as an operation and difficult to do repeatedly and in real time. At the same time, our cell phone carriers are studying our position every day, all the time. When you make a call, your call detail record indicates the time at which you've recalled or received the call and the location of the cell phone tower that's carrying your signal. With smartphones, GPS data has made that even more fine-grained, able to pinpoint the caller and the receiver of the call by up to 5 meters. So here we see the cell phone data on the network in Rome, the summer of 2006. This is the World Cup soccer match. Italy has just beat France. I think there was some sort of controversial headbutt at some point in this game, but everyone's picked up their phone and is calling to celebrate, and you see where the hot spots are in the city, where have people been watching the game, and this is just one of a series of images where you can actually see people move and parade through the streets to celebrate Italy's win in the World Cup soccer game. here's another interesting example of how we are using new technology to reveal some of the hidden dimensions, in this case not of the city, but of a national system. It was a pilot project done with MIT and a number of volunteers in Seattle, where they tagged 3,000 waste objects with RFID trackers and followed them as they moved through the waste disposal infrastructure. And this was studied at the scale of Seattle, at a regional scale. But most interesting for us was when we looked at it at the national scale, and we saw that trash had moved from Seattle all across the country, and in some cases, back to Seattle. So making this information, it is complex. We talked a lot about complexity this morning at the NCC, but making it simple to read and to communicate had a huge impact. The volunteers all changed their behavior with respect to waste when they had seen how one plastic bottle would travel the entire country before it ended up in a landfill or a recycling center. One last example of how of new techniques for visualizing the sort of underbelly of the city. This is a project started by a dear friend of mine, a fellow Canadian, I think a Waterloo student, and then studied at McGill. Now works at Sensible City Lab by the name of Nusha Gailey. It's called Underworlds. She and her team took on the very dirty but incredibly interesting task or challenge of mining the city's sewer systems for data. And so what they did is they sent two robots by the name of Mario and Luigi down into the sewers to collect data, but excrement. And what they were able to do with that is create a sort of urban microbiome, a survey of all the microbes in the city. And they're working with health policymakers to test the impact of policy on the health of at a city scale, and also to try to spot outbreaks before they become full-blown epidemics. So to sum up, sensing technology in big data has paved the way for new approaches to studying representations of today's cities. But what about tomorrow's cities? How can we make a decision about the future together? Herbert Simon, also Albert Einstein, many others, have described the natural sciences as being concerned with how things are, but design is concerned with how things ought to be. And at our work at Carlo Ratti Associati, we really try to push ourselves and put ourselves in a future scenario and illustrate how the future could look based on what we're observing today. A few examples of this in the mobility space, studying the impact of self-driving cars and car sharing. Some of the work that we've been doing at MIT has brought up some preliminary estimates that we could run major cities with 20% of the cars that we have today if we use self-driving cars and car sharing. And we at Carlo Ratti Associati then think, well, how is that going to change the city? These cars, autonomous vehicles, car sharing, don't need different infrastructure than we have today. The real change is some of the infrastructure that we have in place will become redundant. If you were to take 8 out of 10 cars off the road today, we need less lanes, we need less parking, and how can we start to adapt that infrastructure for something else? This is a rendering that we used, I don't want to say as propaganda, but to help us make a case with a developer in Singapore, Singapore being one of the cities that's really at the forefront of autonomous vehicles, to convince them to build their parking above ground, to use as few ramping and sloping surfaces as possible, and to increase the floor to ceiling height enough that it could be repurposed as amenity space or office space in the future when the need for parking is reduced. Another trend or phenomenon that we're studying in relation to the fourth industrial revolution is how and what will robotization, what will the effects be on our cities? One study by the Oxford's Martin School predicted that in the next 5 years, 45% of jobs in the US could be lost to machines. So Google gave us a call and asked us to reflect on this robotization of society. And we thought of a number of practical applications for robots, but given that it was a party, the Google I/O event in San Francisco, we said, let's really have fun with this. Let's come up with a crazy idea. And what we came up with, the Bionic Bar by MakerShaker, ended up being its own company. They replaced the bartender with robots that you can communicate communicate through, can communicate with through an app. And my you know, one initial reaction to this is, you know, why do you have to get rid of the bartender? I like the bartender. I want to talk to the bartender. But it really wasn't about replacing the bartender. It was about looking at how artificial intelligence and how robotization will put the user at the center of the production process. We allow people to create their own cocktail, decide the amounts of each liquor or mixer, control the robots as they stir and shake and muddle. It created some of the worst cocktails ever, but it really puts the user at the center of the production process and allows them to create a customized product. A third phenomenon that we're studying both at Carlo Ratti Associati and at MIT Sensible City Lab is the misalignment of energy used for mechanical and electrical systems with occupancy. There are entire buildings, rooms, lobbies being heated, cool, and lit when there's no one there. And how we know this is we've been using occupancy sensors, and those sensors both identified the problem but are becoming part of the solution. We've been developing prototypes that look at how to couple heating and cooling and lighting infrastructure with occupancy. And one recent project that has just opened in Italy took this one step further. This is the headquarters for Fondazione Agnelli, the family that owns Fiat and now Fiat Chrysler. Here, in parallel with the design of the building, we designed an application that would allow users and office tenants to access the building, to buy something at the cafeteria, to book a meeting room, to book a workstation at the hot desking area, and to adjust the settings of the fan coil units above their head and the lighting. So you could decide what your perfect temperature and lighting levels are, and then you could walk around the building and they would follow you. And the implication of this is when you leave a space, when a space is left empty, it goes on standby like your computer. So we're not heating and cooling and lighting empty spaces. Another future scenario that we are very passionate about, CRA, is that we could finally end this war between city and nature. We really see them as one and the same. Humans they have an innate desire to be in nature, to be immersed in nature. We feel better, and yet we spend most of our lives in fish tanks. So we are looking at how, with the use of new technologies like LEDs and hydroponics, we can bring natural systems back into our cities and even start to produce food in our city centers. We had the wonderful opportunity to present this future vision at Toronto's EDIT Festival, the exposition for design, innovation, and technology, where we curated one of the feature exhibitions called The Green and the Gray, that looked at how, both through our work, but then the work of our contemporaries, people are starting to find solutions to bring the green back and mix with the gray. So we can really see cities as natural systems as well. So we're certainly not the first studio to propose futuristic visions for cities. Many avant-garde movements, Le Corbusier's modernist utopias, Super Studio's critique of modernist dystopias. We're not alone in this space. But where we try to differentiate ourselves from those avant-garde movements is really in making it a collective process. No matter how well researched or well represented, the vision of one office or one studio alone cannot align itself with the complexity of our cities and the diversity of their populations. So we really see the 21st century challenge as how to use technology, social media, our newsletter, for instance, has become an important outlet to share ideas with the public and get their feedback so that we can build a collective future together. And I'll share one last project that where we used both provocative images of a possible future and our social media channels and public debate series to really really complete this future crafting process. About a year ago, IBA, the International Building Exhibition, a German-based, not so different from actually the NCC's Capital Urbanism Lab's mandate, came to us and asked us to work on a master plan with them. This is Patrick Henry Village. It's named after an American war hero. It's a former U.S. military base sitting in the Rhine-Neckar Valley. As you can see, it's kind of a little piece of suburban America in some German fields. It's mostly residential. Up at the top of the image, you see the single-family detached homes, and then there's some housing blocks in the middle. There's a school and a casino and a sports center and a supermarket. But it was a fairly insular community. The citizens of neighboring Heidelberg have fond memories of visiting the 4th of July festival that they had at this site. Otherwise, they didn't really meet these Americans, and they didn't really go into this community. But that celebration was one of the few moments that they understood what was going on here and could have a little window into the American way of life. So there was a sort of folklore around this site. But now it was empty. And we met with the citizens of Heidelberg to think about how this space could be transformed. And while they all had fond memories of this place, none of them would agree to live there. They said, yeah, it's great, but I don't want to live there. And in typical German fashion, they said, add a tram, someone will go there, not me, someone will go there. But that really wasn't enough for us. That site had needed a lot of investment in order just to bring those buildings up to German code. And at the moment, none of the academic or industry players in the region wanted to touch that site. The Rhine-Neckar Valley is nicknamed the Silicon Valley of Germany. It's home to BASF Chemical, SAP Software, ABB Robotics. The University of Heidelberg is a huge institution, but none of them would consider this site for one of their satellite campuses. So we thought, we got to create a new identity here from scratch. What can we come up with? And we thought, well, it's an isolated site. It doesn't really touch anything. There's no immediate context to play with. We've got these American dream homes. Could we create the first commune for the sharing economy? This commune would be open to anybody. Heidelberg is mostly students and researchers, but we would invite entrepreneurs and families to move in as well. Moving in meant agreeing to a way of a new lifestyle where you would connect your physical or even service-oriented assets to a digital network that could be shared with others in the community. And we used renderings and 3D models and collages to show the citizens of Heidelberg how this could look. So we took the residential garages and we started to connect them and open them up, and they became co-working spaces and fab labs. One of the most iconic images was this one, where we took some of the co-living blocks that could not be salvaged, and we started to dig into them and add flexible partitions and an overhead crane so people could rearrange the space however they saw fit in any moment. Some of the other co-living blocks became sort of Airbnb blocks, where you had small private units that could be rented out or shared, but most of the spaces became public spaces. Even the private yards between the buildings could be used by everyone. And we weren't really sure what the reaction would be. We went to the citizens of Heidelberg and we presented these images, and we shared them through our social media channels and through our newsletter and with our client. And both the local and the international press really took to this idea of a commune for the sharing economy and started to spread the images all over the web. And before you knew it, we were getting phone calls and emails from residents such as this lady who said, you know, I saw this project on BBC, how do I sign up? Where do I move in? I would like to move in right away. And at the same time, our client was receiving phone calls from the same institutions that had ignored the site for years, were now interested in setting up a satellite campus at Patrick Henry Commune. So this new identity wasn't beloved by all. It brought up a lot of debate, but people started getting vocal. This is an image from the last town meeting where the mayor was present and the other architects who collaborated on it, and everyone became very vocal. But the main takeaway was that we had to leverage the momentum that this press release had created and the excitement that it had generated about the site. To recap, images that we produce in our design work are not mute, they're not neutral. As the famous landscape architect James Corner wrote, we are trained to visualize the landscape, and those visualizations really determine and condition how the land will be shaped and how the land will be understood. I want to end with one image of the city where I'm living now, Turin, Italy, and four figures, 2, 50, 75, and 80. While cities represent only 2% of the Earth's surface, they are home to 50% of the world's population, more than 50% of the world's population. They consume 75% of all of our energy, and they produce 80% of the carbon dioxide emissions. So if we can use, as designers, images to provoke discussion about the futures of cities and more sustainable cities, we can have an incredible impact. Thank you.
So good evening. Thank you so much for the invitation. After an 8-year stateside hiatus, I'm so honored to be home and to be presenting in our capital. I'm going to be talking about one very seemingly banal way of imaging the city, but it's a very powerful way of doing it. I'm going to be talking about land use zoning maps. And I'm going to show one case study based in South Florida, where we're trying to transform them. When writing about urbanism, political scientist and anthropologist James S. Scott said in his book, Seeing Like a State, How Certain Schemes to Improve the Human Condition Have Failed, says, certain forms of knowledge require a narrowing of vision, bringing into sharp focus a certain limited aspect of an otherwise far more complex and unwieldy reality. This very simplification makes the phenomena at the center of the field of vision more legible and hence more susceptible to careful measurement and calculation. And in this photograph by the Canadian artist Edward Pratinsky, you see this coming together very nicely. Land surveying via the Jeffersonian grid, the 1 mile by 1 mile grid that basically proliferates most of the continent, land use zoning, in this case you see the residential use versus the agricultural use versus the open or conservation one, and further the subdivision of land via market-driven forces. The radically simplified city plan, provided it is viewed from above, is practical and efficient, says Scott. The logic behind spatial segregation and zoning is at once aesthetic, scientific, and practical. It leads to visual regularity, even regimentation. It reduces the number of unknowns for which the planner has to find a solution. Too many unknowns in urban planning rendered any solution problematic or else requiring heroic assumption. Compared to uniformity, diversity is always more difficult to design, build, and control. A tier of invisible codes conceived of and repeatedly ratified beyond the control of designers remain the most effective instruments that shape our physical environments. The tools of the rational comprehensive planning model, armed with judicial powers, have been shaping the North American territory unchallenged and marginally altered for well over two centuries. In front of you are 300 years worth of codes and standards that basically shape the continent. Sorry, they're a little too small to see, but the idea here is to just give you an impression of, you know, the magnitude of them. From the early tools of the surveyors, to the first sewerage guidelines and nuisance ordinances, from neo-traditional form-based codes to the universally adopted land-based classification standards that we use all around the world. Some of these codes, such as the ones adopted in the post-war years, remain the most powerful and ubiquitous. Their danger is that they give us the illusion that we can neatly organize the complexity and dynamism of our world into this static RGB spectrum. The models extend the notion of classifying land uses by redefining traditional categories into multiple dimensions, activities, functions, building types, but essentially their main goal is to separate the uses of land. And as such, land-based classification standards provide a consistent model for classifying land uses based on their characteristics, while ignoring the context in which these characteristics lie. So they're the exact same ones whether you're in Ottawa or you're in Florida. You describe you're using the exact same tools. Their problem is that while they're very powerful tools, because they're a kind of legal document, they're a legal way of imaging the city, there's almost an extreme direct, a one-to-one direct direction between what is drawn and what is built, even in places as complex as the Floridian swamps. So that with a T-square and a triangle, finally the municipal engineer could, without the slightest training as either an architect nor a sociologist, plan a metropolis. In essence, a lot of the particularities of the context are greatly diminished when the majority of our cities are in effect zoned and not planned. So why does this matter today more than ever? And I'm going to tell you a little story. In November of 2016, an octopus made its way into a parking garage in Miami Beach and instantly became a social media sensation. A king tide flooding event, a seasonal phenomenon brought upon by the supermoon, carried the creature deep into the fabric of the city. Because the water levels in the Biscayne Bay near Miami have risen so much in the last few years, salt water from the sea and the animals that it carries with it has begun infiltrating deep into the city and its fabric, creating what they call sunny day floods. And a recent study found that since 2006, high tide flooding has soared by 400%. And these are just some photos that I took last October in Fort Lauderdale during one of these king tide events. So it was a perfectly dry, beautiful day, and the whole city was flooding. And with nearly 20 million residents, South Florida is one of, of North America's fastest growing regions. And it continues to urbanize. It continues to urbanize at a really rapid pace. And it's easy to forget that cities such as Miami and Fort Lauderdale and West Palm Beach are all in fact surrounded by, water from three sides. The Everglades to the west, the Atlantic to the east, and the Biscayne Aquifer right below their feet. Or like I like to call them, they exist in a terra sorta firma, where the ground is neither wet nor dry, but is in a constant state of hydrological flux. And just as a side note, 80% of the world's cities actually exist in a very similar context to this. They're mostly in estuaries or river valleys or coastal zones. So they're not really unique in that regard, except it's just a little exaggerated. And over the past century, Floridians have put an estimated $101 billion worth of property below sea level. They continue to build, you know, things like this. Unfortunately, you know, other than the acres of suburban planned unit developments that I just showed you, this is what the majority of architects and planners continue to build in Florida. Fancy glass towers designed by Starkitects and faux European plazas designed by the developers, right? So they make it snow there in Christmas just for the experience, right? And more ironically, the powers that be refuse to acknowledge that there's even a problem, you know, meeting it with extreme skepticism. Here you see the governor kind of banning the term climate change from the state documents. So, you know, an ostrich putting its head in the sand. You know, even though scientific papers such as this one that published just a couple months ago confirmed that Florida is in even deeper trouble than anticipated. So it's kind of worse. The condition is there, you know, a little worse than they even imagined. And despite this grim outlook, a very progressive and unique form of regional governance dealing with climate change specifically appeared in 2010. The four southern counties created the South Florida Climate Change Compact in order to coordinate mitigation and adaptation activities across county lines. So this is a very unique novel form of governance based specifically for climate change, which is rare and we don't see that very often. And desperately looking for answers, I've been working with Broward County in order to incorporate kind of a new way of thinking of their planning documents and urban design manuals. Because some of the main problems we began to see is something like this. So here you see all the different sea level rise projections for South Florida, and then ridiculously juxtaposed against their approved land use zoning map. So on the right, you see 2 feet of sea level rise, which is the kind of gray blob, overlaid on top of their 2060 land use zoning map, which is still being zoned as if nothing is happening, right? And let me remind you, 2 feet of sea level rise is 2-foot-long subs. So we're not talking about massive amounts of water. It's just the lower end of the predictions. And one of the only times that you see a zoning map overlaid with a flood map, which is not something you see very often. And we brought up this quote to tell them that, you know, while zoning will zoning adequately expand and contract in response to changed circumstances as sublocal and global changes mount? So when the U.S. Supreme Court mandated zoning, they also wondered if it would be also dynamic and flexible to deal with some of the pressures we're going to be seeing in the future. So part oversight, part politics, resulted in the inability of administrative planning tools to accommodate dynamic environmental systems and processes in the shaping of the physical fabric of our city. And here we did a survey of all the existing sort of standard regulatory planning tools in Broward County to understand where some of those shortcomings might be. And then the next phase is in collaboration with the MIT Urban Risk Lab, headed by Professor Miho Mazaru, we've been working in developing a platform that allows the residents and officials to understand the relationship between zoning codes and the environmental processes of their context. There's already many existing various online mapping tools that show the effects of vulnerabilities of climate change, but they don't ever offer a way of actionable insights. They don't offer a way of moving forward and what to do with that information. So we tried to overlay some of the geospatial information with existing planning tools and codes from the municipalities, as well as live stream dynamic data, and then begin to output it in different ways to different users. And here's just one example of what a live stream, is it playing? Oops. This is one example of one of the many live stream mapping platforms that exist out there that will show you kind of live information such as wind, precipitation, and waves in real time. And for the platform, we started to talk about finding ways to use digital descriptions of ecomorphological attributes such as soil permeability, base flood elevation, seasonal water table heights, and storm surge. We're using a bunch of algorithms through all the mapping layers that we have to begin to create a series of discrete zones that can inform targeted interventions and direct built form and zoning codes in what we're trying to call a kind of flux zone overlay. One of the first things that this platform began to show us is that if you start understanding some of the geospatial information sectionally, that you will start to zone the city will be zoned a little bit differently. This is lagging a little bit behind, but what the right image is trying to show you is the different contours, and when you click on a property, eventually you will be able to see the sort of water table heights. So I'm just gonna let it run for 2 seconds so you could see that. I have a still of it in the next slide. So one of the key features of the platform is that it combines existing live and projected water table map with a proposed land use zoning designation in section. So you can see how much or how little groundwater storage potential exists below your property. And it can also start to direct the municipality to permit and zone building use uses and heights in relation to a future water table map. So for example, where the topography is the highest along a place like the ridge, you can allow buildings to be taller. I know this sounds like a very kind of straightforward idea, but for them this is somewhat revolutionary, that you start to zone buildings and height densities in relation to something that you're mapping sectionally. So understanding how far the water elevation is from the ground level will have a direct relationship to how tall buildings will go. And so creating gradients of permitted uses and zoning types that have a direct relationship to projected environmental conditions and vulnerabilities. Our goal is to develop a comprehensive platform for communities and decision makers to help understand the potential adaptability of the urban fabric and assist the translation of mitigation efforts into planning goals. Right? So here's one example of how we're beginning to do that. So we're beginning to propose a series of responsive urban codes and standards that deal with hydrology, topography, solar orientation, and other environmental parameters as the primary determinants of land use and built form. So again, for example, drainage and water flow dictates building orientation versus normative things like streets, all right? Or an idea that a park space of a certain size and dimension in a certain location with certain soil attributes has to become water storage, which is something that I guess is also something you would think would be straightforward and simple, but it's illegal to zone parkland as water storage. But here, you know, these are things that should be thought of in unison. And what that does, it generates a set of responsive, scenario-driven urban proposals versus kind of overlaying a static or deterministic one, which what typical land use zoning codes do. Also generating a very novel type of urban morphology that is giving, in this example here on a greenfield site, a space for both flooding and density to coexist. And one other example of this is we use the gradients of inundation. This is a great project by a bunch of students that took this idea while we were at MIT and tried to run with it as part of a studio that Miho and I taught. And they took the gradients of inundation, open space ratios, clustering, and cut and fill operation that then dictated how the land was subdivided and how the standards of, you know, things like building code and building relationships of building to site plan were driven by gradients of inundation. So this kind of eventually will create this idea that as water levels fluctuate or other variables stay cold, the same land parcel may begin to serve as both productive, for productive purposes, for development purposes, infrastructural, and for ecosystem services, depending on the season or time of day or time of year. So, and we just have to design them to do so and enable them to do so. And let me remind you that, you know, while Florida's problems might seem really far away from here, the last time there was a comprehensive update of Canada's flooding maps was when Pierre Trudeau was prime minister, and Ontario had 3 million people, fewer people living in the province. And despite massive amounts of urban development, increased episodic flooding like the ones we saw this last spring due to climate change, and rapid technological advancement for refined tracking and mapping of flooding, Conservation Ontario estimates that about 74 to 78% of our floodplain maps in the province are out of date. So how are we to make informed decisions about the future of our cities if we don't fully understand the systems that underlie them? So this is one end of the problem. The other thing is, as designers, many of us are not that interested in these tools. So I would just say that, you know, in imaging the city, we need to begin to inherently question the binaries of wet and dry, land and water, dense and open, and dissolve them into gradients that respond to some of these uncertain futures. Thank you.
It's very strange to be on this side of the podium for this event. When I became the director of the Carleton Immersive Media Studio in 2007, I was interested in developing models that could be used at multiple scales and for multiple applications. And I was also intrigued by the idea of using building information modeling, relatively new at the time, to record existing conditions. For those of you who don't know what building information modeling is, or BIM as its acronym is pronounced, it's essentially the linking of architectural geometry to a database or databases. So you have an object that looks like a building and then information that's related to that object. I was also interested in exploring how BIM could benefit the management of architectural conservation and the process of architectural rehabilitation. 10 years ago, there were relatively few groups in the world that were looking at these questions. Tonight, I'm not going to talk about all of the projects we have undertaken at Sims over the past decade. Rather, I'd like to show you the various scales we are attempting to work at and how we are trying to understand and represent them as one continuous whole. My team at Sims has put together a 13-minute animation. They put in some long hours over the past couple of weeks. And I'm hoping that this will provide a kind of an introduction to this work. This is something new. I've never actually tried presenting this way before, so please bear with me. Usually I use an image to remind me what it is that I was going to say, so we'll see how this works out. If nothing else, at least the images will look nice. And initially I said that what I was going to do is just play saxophone over top the animation, but my saxophone playing is actually quite dreadful. So I'd also invite you to contact me if you see anything that is of interest, if you're interested in learning more, or come by and visit us. If we could start the animation now, please. This first project is a project that we did with Public Services and Procurement Canada, Heritage Conservation Services, and the Dominion sculptor Phil White. The relief sculpture was captured in situ using photogrammetry, and that information was used to create a very detailed mesh model. The mesh model was used to create a replica in high-density foam, and this is the stone as it exists in situ. It's about 1 by 2 meters. We milled out the existing conditions in high-density foam using a CNC router. The Dominion sculptor then used modeling clay to rehabilitate the sculpture on the high-density foam, and there you can see a detail of his work. He's an incredibly talented individual. The rehabilitated sculpture was then scanned using a hand scanner and remeshed. And then this mesh was used to plan tool path for a 6-axis robot that was used to mill the rehabilitated sculpture in sandstone. And then that's the object as it came out from the robot. And then the Dominion sculptor finished the piece by hand. And we've coined the term digitally assisted fabrication for this process. One advantage is that the stone could be left in situ during the rehabilitation process. This is our first major project in this area, and we've been praised and damned for it. But we have developed a strong relationship with the Dominion sculptor, and we have several ongoing projects, as well as our own robotic cells. We've also worked at the scale of individual buildings, and this is highlighting some of the work we've done on Parliament Hill over the last 4 years. We've developed a building information model of the center block. And this model will be used by the architects and engineers in the rehabilitation project that will be happening over the next decade. The model was built using data from terrestrial laser scanning as well as original drawings. As part of the same project, we have also modeled parts of the East Block. The model was built primarily from photogrammetric data, 3D information generated from 2D photographs. And as you can see, we were able to achieve a very high level of detail because of that photogrammetric information. The West Block was modeled exclusively from terrestrial laser data. We first modeled the building prior to the fit-up, and we are now modeling the rehabilitated new spaces, including the temporary House of Commons in the courtyard of the West Block and the new Visitor Welcome Center. Our most recent project on the Hill is the Library of Parliament, and it was an absolute joy to get to spend so much time inside this beautiful space. Many times it was just myself and the scanner. As the director, I have certain privileges. We have over 90 scans of the interior, and the model is our most detailed building information model to date. We've also modeled the topography of the site, including all of the site fittings. This was built using existing geospatial data as well as our own terrestrial laser scanning data. We have a lot of tours coming through Sims, and inevitably the question would be, just how much of the city have you modeled like this? So last summer we put together a concept model of Confederation Boulevard, an amazing collection of important sites around the National Capital Region managed by our friends at the National Capital Commission. And this, again, was really just a concept idea that we were coming up with and a way to do some research for the final project that I'm going to talk about today. The idea was to explore how much information is already available and to determine the level of effort that would be needed to complete a model of this scale at the resolution of the Parliament buildings. So these are just the different sites on Confederation Boulevard. If you go to the National Capital Commission's website, all of these sites are, information on all of these sites are available. And this isn't a sales pitch, Mark, but at the sort of simplest level, existing information could simply be plugged into a kind of a click and view the information related to the site. Now, as I mentioned, this was a concept model that we built as part of research for another project. At about the same time we were developing this, a gentleman who's sitting in the front row came to visit us, along with a colleague of mine, Ben Gianni. And we were talking about a model of the city. Does a model of the city actually exist? Or again, what would be the level of effort required in order to build a model of the national capital? Again, building a city model is nothing new, but our approach is to think, again, a city model as a sort of a geometric reconstruction, but our approach is to think of the model as a giant building information model. So again, the architectural geometry is evident. You can recognize things by looking at them. But that geometry is actually links to information. So you're thinking, well, that's just like Google Earth, right? Except that this would be an asset that's not controlled by a private corporation. I don't know if that bothers the rest of you that Google controls all that information, but it bothers me. The challenge with a project like this, of course, is funding and who's going to pay for it. Well, what we discovered, in fact, is that already most of it has been paid for, and sometimes twice. So right now, we're working with, I won't name any names, but we're working with colleagues of a number of public and private organizations across the region to bring together all digital assets together into a common data environment that can be freely available to anyone who wants or needs to use it. So in the model of the city that we've put together to date, and again, this is really quite a high-level concept model, but the idea would be that we would draw on data that we have already acquired. So again, the work we've been doing on Parliament Hill, but other projects that we've, other models that we've built in the city over the past decade, and then again we would ask our partner organizations to contribute the models or terrestrial scan data or photogrammetric data that they've acquired over the years, and just put it all together and share it, rather than having to rescan or remap or resurvey different projects. So these are just some projects, again, that we've done over the years that we feel could be integrated into the model. Some of this information is pulled from exhibition projects, but all of that is actually modeled as building information model, just rendered a bit fancy. This is a private project that we did on the former Domtar sites. We have the entire site scanned, most of it modeled. My colleague, Mario Santana, as part of class he teaches, has been recording sites all around the city, a number of properties that are owned by the National Capital Commission. So again, all of that data exists. This is a model that we've built of the Carleton University campus. And again, these are the projects that my colleague Professor Santana has been recording over the last few years. So as I mentioned, our work on Confederation Boulevard in the city of Ottawa were also preliminary research for a project that we initiated with the Ontario East Economic Development Commission over a year ago. This is a project. This is the concept model we developed for them, and the project is now fully funded and under development. The region of Ontario East is the area that they manage is 55,000 square kilometers. We haven't built a model this big, and I've been perfectly clear to them. I'm not exactly sure how we're going to do it, but that's what research is all about. So the first thing we looked at was demonstrating industrial capacity. So if a company is looking for a certain type of property with certain requirements for infrastructure, could you do a search, find options, and then start to drill down for more information, even all the way down to a 3D view of the property? And this in our conversation with Ontario East, this could also be a way to monetize the project and pay for maintenance and ongoing development. So if a company wanted something like this, this kind of very fine-grained representation, they would have to pay for the development of that service. And this is just some, again, repurposed scan data that we had that we plopped down on the landscape. The next thing we looked at was modeling information related to certain sectors. So in this case, all of the craft breweries in the region, and this was a very popular project with our students, you could also identify related industries. So farmers who grow things that you need to make beer would be part of this information, and this is fairly standard GIS layering. Like the industrial example above, you could also drill down for more information. So if you actually wanted to have a 3D tour of the brewery, you could do so. And of course, this could be done on your browser, or it could be done with a headset, another area of work that we've been doing over the last year. And again, we're also exploring the possibility of e-commerce. So many of these companies already sell their product online, so this could be another way to market to the consumer. And this is again a walk in through some terrestrial laser scanning data. Now, additional information could also include distribution networks, marketing areas, and consumer patterns. So if a company was thinking of relocating to Ontario East, they would be able to just check out where their competition might be, how easy it would be to get their product to market, and then how close they are to distribution. When Ontario East Economic Development Commission came back to us in the fall and said they were ready to move forward with the project, we assumed that the proof of concept would be the same data set that we had been developing for the concept model, so beer. However, they have tasked us to build a model that represents the agri-food industry in Eastern Ontario. Some 18,000 individual contributors over that 57,000 square kilometers. We hope to have the model online by September 2019. Thank you very much.
Hello? Oh, we're on. Excellent. So our format for this next portion, we're going to try to keep our own comments and questions pretty brief. I'm going to ask a question and then Stanwell, and then we're hoping that you all have your own questions that you've developed. So thank you, first of all. Those are fantastic presentations, a lot to think about. And such diverse work, it's hard to link together, but I'm going to try. So I have a little question. So I think for all of you, the work was working with multiple layers, making really complex systems visible, and especially making large quantifiable data, things like traffic or things like temperature, flooding visible. And then for all of the projects, and I think you made it clear, so I'm almost asking you to just reiterate and then project forward, that each of those imagings has something very important that's both social and political built into it, very important questions. So I'm wondering if you could talk about the way, in particular projects, but also thinking about how these techniques and visualizations might evolve going forward, about the ways that these techniques respond to social, cultural, political issues, human factors like security, opportunity, diversity, and in particular, how you imagine these techniques might help non-specialists, so maybe not your client always, but help non-specialists to understand the links between the large forces, future urban development, and then what might be the individual experience and how that might allow communities to have a more active role in decision making about resources and development.
Great. Shall I start? Ladies first? Okay. Well, there were many, many different questions. I'll address some, but not all. To the issue of complexity, as I mentioned previously, especially with the big data dimension, it is very difficult to summarize these conditions that are really in flux and to pause the animation and say, we're going to make a decision about this. But the field of data visualization is so important to make these complex systems legible, and I think as architects, we're well equipped to do this. I mean, we're already managing so many different sub-consultants and different fields with a sometimes shallow understanding of what each of these means. But our ability to bring these together and make it tangible and clear is very important. Especially, and that brings me to a second point, if we want to engage people to design in an open source way, and that has become really central to the work that we're doing at Carlo Ratti Associati, to work with people. We're studying tools to allow people to participate in the surveying process, to use their smartphones and images that they're taking of sites to start to build these BIM models as well. And a third point about the role in images, We see some of these provocative renderings and possible futures as analogous to what is called white hacking. It's where hackers will try to disrupt a system, not to harm it, but to say, hey, this is really possible. This could happen. Let's think about how to solve this issue together. So bringing to the fore and showing where this could lead is important to sort of get people out of their seats and try and come up with a solution for the cities of tomorrow together.
Thank you. For us, definitely public access by the public is very important to what we've been doing. And we've been working with Public Services and Procurement Canada to leverage a lot of the material that we've been developing for the rehabilitation project on the Hill as really a communications platform, so people understand what's happening. But as I mentioned, the urban model, I think, is something I feel particularly strong about, and also making it available to the public. And again, as you say, in a way that and as a tool that allows people to actually use it. And I think there are existing softwares that can be augmented that will allow people to just, you know, have a walk through the city and see what that new building is really going to how it's going to affect their neighborhood.
I would say from my end that one of the things that might seem pretty logical, like different city departments overlaying their maps to understand the system, sometimes actually just doesn't happen. So, you know, starting with like overlaying a future land use zoning map with a flood map revealed new information that they probably should have been talking to each other before they dictate certain decisions, or overlaying, you know, saltwater intrusion that is corroding sewer lines with where new sewers are being replaced, right? So sometimes just a simple coupling of data that otherwise took a kind of academic institution to take that labor to say, hey, let's take a bunch of maps that you never usually would, you know, overlay with each other and see where future vulnerabilities or opportunities maybe is one way of doing this. And then the other thing is the sort of idea that you can visualize something differently. So just starting to see a place in section rather than planimetrically at all points also revealed a new way of reading a city. So the combination of geology and water table with the idea of registering building heights and building densities with something that you usually don't really read with each other, but sometimes in a context like this would make sense. So I would say the idea that you might, and then the idea that this platform would be also publicly accessible, that you can just go on a website, you don't need to know GIS, you don't need to know how to download data, that you can just kind of access this information from your home and know through live data or a live feed the level of the water table below your feet is maybe scary but very revelatory for a lot of people. So I think it's the combination of taking this kind of information that is out there, combining it in ways that usually would not be combined, but also just kind of making a synthesis of it in a way where the public can have a new way of reading their context that otherwise they would not have been able to.
Thanks. So I'd like to explore the concept of the public access a little to another, take it another step further. For example, we at the NCC, when we work on our long-range plans and all the work that we do a lot of public consultation. So imaging is very important to that work, to show people or how things may be envisioned in the future, but also to get them involved in that. So I'm curious, I guess this would be more for Emma and Fadi. Like, for example, the commune example, obviously there were static images that you used, but the big data based, the GIS layers, how can that be used to create images that get the message across and allow for interactivity with the public as well? Was the public or the groups that you worked with, are they able to get into, use this new technology to create a better shredding process, to create better interactivity and better input and feedback? Same thing for Broward County, when you're going to public consultations and you're seeing that. How can this new technology be used to further the whole public consultation agenda and openness and transparency, not only access to be able to look at it on a screen?
Do you want to start?
I mean, yeah, I mean, I can just expand a little bit on what I was saying before. Is I think, I mean, we still haven't used this in any public consultation-wise, but this is one of the things that the government officials have been really excited about, the potential of platforms like this to help the public sort of educate themselves and their communities about the environmental conditions that underlie their cities, right? So a lot of times, systems like water is invisible. Like, you just kind of get, until it breaks, you know, until a sewer pipe breaks or the tide comes in, or it's kind of always been out of sight, out of mind. And then all of a sudden, when a disaster happens or a kind of anomaly condition takes place, people then say, oh, there's water now on my street where it was not before. But understanding that something is always there and it's actually a system that has helped, you know, shape them is kind of one level of kind of, I don't know, like public literacy of systems that would have been invisible, right? So a lot of times we put our rivers in underground and we put them in pipes and we hide them from view, and then now this is a way of people always understanding that the water table is always actually below their feet, and when the tide comes in and it starts to burst from the sewer pipes or from their sometimes their own lawns, they know that what are the forces, the bigger forces that are there and having an influence on their urban fabric. So I would say it's, on the one hand, people also are, people who live in a context for a long time get to know it really, really well, and sometimes just showing it to them in a different way or in a different light also becomes revelatory. So while you might have residents who've lived in on the same street for 30 years, all of a sudden when they see, you know, that they live on actually the highest point, which is this ridge, and now this ridge is gonna get densified because it is a safe high zone, what is it? Why is that now a kind of, you know, a good strategy, right, in the context of the county? So I would say it's when you see your own individual home or your individual neighborhood in relation to a bigger system or a bigger environment, it might help, you know, might help you rethink your values and your ideas and, you know, what your aspirations would have been for your own neighborhood.
I have two suggestions about how to disseminate the lessons learned from big data to the public, and one is also just a compliment to your presentations, which were so beautiful, and I think that gets overlooked sometimes. We really got to make it beautiful. In Italy, where when we're smashing our hands against the wall, to, you know, what are we even trying to represent here? Is it clear? I don't know. I've been staring at this screen for so long, and someone just says, oh, "Fallo bello," make it beautiful. Let's make it beautiful and move on. And the image from Rome, for instance, was part of a larger exhibition where we had these beautiful transparent screens where the data really came alive, and people were so captivated that they stayed and they started to absorb and they got interested. So it's a superficial thing maybe, but I think it's very important. It's, and I know that there's probably many students in the room who are spending hours and hours trying to make their work beautiful for their final presentations in a few weeks, but it really is so important. I mean, you have to make things beautiful for people to love them and to absorb that information. And the other thing is about the source of big data. There are three, more or less three different ways that you can collect data. Purpose-built sensing, where you install sensors to take a specific type of data. The city of Rio has been investing a lot in cameras and sensors throughout the city, and they have this big data center where they see everything going on in the city 24 hours for disaster relief, but also traffic control, and they've invested in those purpose-built sensors. Another way is opportunistic sensing, where you can use existing data that's intended for one thing but can be used for another. The example of Rome that I showed earlier, where cell phone data was being used to look at activity in the city in a more social way. But where we've had the most success in engaging people to understand and to internalize information is when we made them part of that process, where we use crowdsourced data, images from Twitter, posts on Instagram, start to use what content people have given you to create a story, to create a narrative. It's the most difficult type of data to work with because it's a bit random, it's incomplete in some parts, but Google Waze, for instance, uses people's information about traffic updates that are sent in from drivers to create a real-time visualization of what the traffic scenarios are. So involving people in the collection of data, in the production of data, and then showing it to them in a really beautiful way would be my suggestion.
Great.
Yeah, I think we'll turn it over to the audience in 2 seconds, but the one thing I'd say to that is beauty is so important, but I'm always fascinated by failure as well. And Fadi, when I look at your images, with the processing power we have now, I really am compelled by the idea of scenario modeling, especially around sea level rise and climate data, where you actually allow an input group to play with different massing strategies. And when you drop those mega towers all over Miami, you see the client, the input group gets to play with it and say, okay, we play with this development model and actually 50% of the city is underwater in 10 years, which is a nice, I look forward to seeing that next time. The disaster strategy, beautiful disaster. Anyhow, we should probably turn it over to the audience. If we have people, we have a microphone on either side.
Please feel free to ask your questions. On peut prendre des questions en français aussi.
We just can't see.
Hi there. I work in the video game industry. And so in video games, we have a lot of city building, city modeling in 3D. And I just wonder, like I'm kind of new to this, to your industry, but I don't know if you've approached any video game companies that are doing this, like Ubisoft, who recently just painstakingly recreated ancient Egypt in their latest game. If you've thought about partnering with them at all in any capacity and what that would look like.
We are currently working in Unreal Engine, trying to bring our models into that environment, and we built 5 passive VR experiences this past summer, again as a communications tool for Public Services Procurement Canada to help explain what the rehabilitation project was all about. So yeah, we're definitely that's an area that we're moving into, and I know a lot of larger architectural corporations are moving into VR environments, particularly the HTC Vive. Which allows you to actually walk around in a constructed space, in a digital space, untethered now. So yes, and we're always looking for new projects. So please feel free to contact me. Shameless.
We'll take a question from this side of the room.
I noticed that, is it Fadi? You showed a scene of the flooding in Gatineau. And I haven't been able to follow closely the news stories on this, but my understanding is that at first the authorities were not allowing people to rebuild in the areas that were expected to be flooded again. And as we know, these floods are seeming to occur more frequently than in the past. And then they backtracked and said, well, okay, we'll let you build there. I don't know if you know about that or if you have any comments about what has been happening, the wisdom of what's happening, et cetera.
So I would say there's maybe 2 ways to respond to that. The first is a lot of times, a lot of our planning decisions are being dictated by flood insurance, you know, and flood insurance companies rather than planners. So there's a whole other discussion of how our cities are basically designed by, you know, economists and insurance companies and things like this, who are actually not the ones who are best fit to decide how we build a city, but it all ends up, you know, boiling down to things like insurance and policy. But then I would say the other thing is we've always lived near the water. You know, cities existed, they've always had a relationship with water and with rivers and flooding. And I would say moving forward, if you're ever gonna live near water, you just have to accept the fact that some places will and might flood. We just have to build differently. You know, the idea, especially in a place like Florida. So Florida is a really interesting case study just because the effects are really exaggerated and are clear, and they're kind of chronic. It's like a chronic condition versus all of a sudden it floods in you know, the St. Lawrence River Valley, or, and it's not sudden, it's always flooded, you know, but now we build so close to these things and we get really, you know, mortified when the floods damage our homes, when in reality a floodplain or a flooding condition is the norm, right? So I would say if we're gonna live there, we just have to live differently. We gotta build our houses differently. We gotta create more places for the water to go. So kind of debunking the myth that cities should exist in a solely dry condition and that water is a thin blue line drawn on a map that separates dry from wet, when in reality it's a gradient. So I don't know about the exact condition and when people move back in, but knowing that our floodplain maps are out of date in the first place, and the idea that water is there and the city is here, or the river is this thin line that is separating the urban from the water, is a fallacy. So we need to design in, we need to design that threshold and understand that it's never wet or dry, it's always in flux. So maybe that's the first way to kind of begin to replan places that flood occasionally, periodically too.
Thank you.
Next question over this side.
As an urban designer, I often use Google Earth Pro, which is really terrific. I can get down on the street and I can study it from the air, things from the air. But the question that I'm pondering over, and which was brought up a little bit, and I think mentioned when you referred to insurance, is who controls this data? Where, is this publicly accessible? The way it's presented is very much, has been pointed out, very much affects the way you respond to it. Mm-hmm. Who's doing the presenting? Is it the public sector? Is the public good being represented in these things, or is it some commercial interest that might be gaining from that? So would you explore for me that question about public or private? I mean, I refer to Jane Jacobs' Systems of Survival. I don't know if you're familiar with that book, which makes the distinction between essentially the public and private. The moral systems that are in need to be in equilibrium. Neither one needs to be in control, I think. Could you explore that a bit more?
All of us.
Well, I mean, I would just say from my end, it's hopefully for both, that the public benefits from it and the private sector makes wise decisions out of it. But a lot of data comes from this, from public agencies, from, you know, municipalities and other agencies that do the mapping and hopefully has it in an open source. But how the decisions come to be, hopefully, is for both public and for the private sector to do the right thing, hopefully. But as long as the information is out there, the work that we're doing will always be open source and publicly accessible, using a lot of times public data, public maps and GIS levels. But who ends up using it at the end, hopefully, is the public making smart decisions and the private sector, who's building a lot of the buildings in our cities now, also make wise decisions.
Well, you probably heard that in the United States there's a move to repeal some laws that were recently put into under Barack Obama put into place, which kept the internet a free place. So yeah, so a net neutrality. Thank you. Yeah, and there's now a move afoot to repeal those laws, which will allow information providers to charge both people who are providing information, as well as those who are downloading the information. So if you want your information to be more available, you just pay them more. And I find that a very scary prospect for the future. And everyone, I use Google, but they are one of the lead forces in trying to get this legislation repealed. So they are not a benign entity. They're a for-profit corporation. So I think it's important that the public sector provide alternatives to those types of information providers, and particularly for our cities, where, as you pointed out, so many, I mean, over 50% of the population now lives in cities. So I think the provision of information, easily accessible information, is something that the public sector has to take on.
And I agree that I think the city is the right place, not the national or the regional, but really at the city scale. We were speaking earlier this afternoon about one of the initiatives put on by the World Economic Forum to start to evaluate cities and their preparedness for the fourth industrial revolution. The point that we had spoken about this morning was their ability to, or this afternoon was their ability to create comparable data sets that could be overlapped to draw conclusions about different types of data being studied. But the other point was a city's ability to balance data coming from private institutions with an openness for crowdsourced information, for open source data, their willingness to share that with the public, policymakers being on board with this kind of work that I see is already being done by the team at the NCC. So I think the city is the right place to start those conversations.
Thanks. Next question.
Yes, thank you to all of you for your beautiful talks. I have a rather broad question. I want to understand the relationship between computing and architecture, GIS, urban planning, all of these things. And I'm in the shoes a little bit of the first questioner. Also, I'm coming from a kind of computer wireless programming background. And maybe the motivation for my question is a little bit, I have a great frustration in my field that I see a lot of very brilliant people in computer science, engineering, who really can do a lot of algorithms, visualizations, all this kind of stuff that you need, but are really working on very uninteresting problems, on unimportant problems, not...
Come work for us.
Yeah, well, I'm always looking for computer.
That's a little bit of what I'm saying, and, you know...
you're hired.
Maybe some of them are stuck in their offices a little bit hidden, maybe they're a little shy, maybe you have to go grab them, I think. Like, I'm trying to understand, like, all of you have teams of n number of people. So I don't know the architecture program, but my understanding is now if you want to do anything in architecture in GIS, it's not just a question you purchase a software, you open up a few layers in it, and you do something. It's more complex than that. You have multiple softwares, you have multiple kinds of data, you have to translate them, you have to script some kind of data pipe, I think. If you want to put that visualization, if you want to put it online, you have to know JavaScript and things like this. So all of these things, you have all this layer, so you have software design, you have programming, you have all those things. And I'm trying to, you know, I have a few thoughts, like, should architecture offer some programming courses? Is it a question of taking architects and teaching them some programming? Is it a question of hiring more programmers? I think it's a bit of both, like, what's the current situation? How can we, I don't know, remedy this or balance things out a little bit, because I see, you know, you can't go anywhere without computation, I think, at this point. So I'd just like to hear your general thoughts on this.
At our office, we do have some in-house programmers. We're a pretty mixed bunch, architects, engineers. We've got a singer-songwriter, a poet, a big communications team, so we're fairly multidisciplinary. But what we tend to amass is a surface level understanding of how all of these tools work. We design knowing the potentials that these tools will offer us, and then we subcontract and work with sub-consultants on when we go to implement or when we want to study something in detail. So I would say probably we're not going to start building our own in-house programming team anytime soon, but it's essential for everybody who's doing the design to understand the potential of those tools. So everybody has to have a base understanding and keep up to date on what can these tools offer us and how do we start to have a conversation with the experts who may be shy and don't want to come to us. So we're always looking to collaborate with different disciplines.
If I could add a parenthesis to this, I just wanted to know also in terms of tools that you use, do you have to buy commercial software now? Is there more trend for open source? Is there open source software that's, does it make sense now to go in that direction? And what about open source data like OpenStreetMap? Is that good enough for most applications or are we really not there yet? So what's the open source versus commercial maybe situation as well on top of my question?
One of the most rare gems you can find in as a research assistant or research associate is usually someone who has computation background and or in architecture and or urbanism. I mean, these are like really sought after researchers because if you have
two students.
Yeah, no, I'm actually serious. It is. I mean, MIT and U of T, we're you're always looking for people who have a programming and computation abilities, but also at the same time have an understanding and at least a very deep interest in urbanism, right? So writing code is one thing, but if you really don't know why you're writing it for, that also becomes another thing. So that's when you find someone who can and is interested in doing both, it's like unbelievable, right? So this is one on the one hand. And the other, we try to use, I mean, I have zero programming and code background whatsoever, but trying to understand things like they use a lot of this program called Python scripting, which is really very common processing, a whole bunch of sort of visual languages that take complex systems again and kind of can insert it into something that is visual and comprehensible and beautiful, right? So that's the other thing too, having a computation person interested in urbanism and also kind of understands and values the aesthetics of the work is, it's like you're getting
you're asking too much.
A hat trick, right? No, but it's a really good question because I think moving forward, a lot of the work we do is digital and digitally, students every generation, every year, not even every generation, the students coming in are more apt and, really facile with using computer programs and 3D visualizations and other tools that they are picking things up faster and faster and faster, right? And we, as we get older and less able, it's a very valid question.
And I'd love to make a very selfish pitch with something I forgot to mention earlier. At Carleton in the last year, another faculty member and I, Ozer Saluji, who I see out there, started a group called the Carleton Urban Research Lab. And for those of you who are bored and working in games and coding and design, we do hope in the next year to have a little fun charrette day with students where they can be introduced to different parallel and more sophisticated often ways of working with 3D tools. So find me after and give me your card, please. Designers are fun. Okay, sorry. Back to the event.
We have a very very mixed house right now. We used to be all architects, because architects can do everything. Then we discovered we couldn't. So we have a very mixed group right now. And again, for us, it's a little different than private industry, so more like Fadi. We're pretty much 90% student-powered. Mm-hmm. So we have architects, we have engineers, we have information technologists, computer scientists, we have a historian who works with us, so it's a similar model, but it's just student-powered. So, but what I've discovered is that people get excited by someone else, just like you are. You see this and you think, wow, I would like to do that. I would like to be able to write code in Python.
Yeah.
So what happens is that when students get together from different disciplines, they get excited by each other's work, and they start to learn from each other. So now we have some of the computer people who are doing some graphic design for the web pages and that sort of thing, and we have some of the architects and engineers who are learning to write code. So it's a kind of a hybrid situation is developing. And on the question of open source versus commercial, my problem with open source software is that who supports that software once it gets out in, into the world? Because we work with architects, engineers, project construction managers, so they're used to using commercial products. Mm-hmm. So our tendency has been to use the commercial products and then rework them so that they work for workflows that they weren't built for. So that's been our approach.
Okay, so we've got about 10 minutes left, and we've got three people with three questions. So we're going to try and get through all three questions and answers in those 10 minutes. All right? Okay, you've been waiting the longest. So.
Thanks. My question is for Fadi. It's a little bit related to the gentleman's about the flooding in Gatineau. With having that information of seeing the flooding accessible to the public, how do you foresee the public taking that information and then basically using it to their own benefit with their own properties? As a homeowner, I know if I had that information and saw that my property was susceptible to flooding, then I would probably want to move and go to another zoning area that was higher, and I know you mentioned densification. How do you see the flooded areas not becoming ghettos and just forgotten areas? What would we do to make them beautiful again rather than just being a neighborhood that's now flooded and rotting?
Right, so I think this is the one thing where we're interested in being proactive rather than reactive. So one strategy is this idea of upzoning and downzoning certain areas. So upzoning the high ground is usually where you incentivize development in areas that you know are safe. And then this idea of downzoning doesn't mean that you let it dilapidate. But this is where it goes back to my first answer. If it's up to the insurance companies dictating what will happen to our cities, then you will end up with this idea of people literally being pushed out eventually when they can't afford their homes, versus being proactive in which you actually design these areas so that, one, the buildings themselves are either lifted up higher, which is something in some places where they have no other option to go other than, you know, live in that context. You start having finished floor elevations that are higher than what would be the max scenario of flooding. And then that ground plane below becomes public realm. A lot of times you design the parks, you design the waterfronts to be flood receptive. So this idea that your entire open systems are all connected with each other and parkland and all that park space also functions as water storage. And a lot of times that finished first floor, sometimes if the buildings are set back from the road, there's an idea that you couple that the infrastructure and the green space are both performing. So the park itself is also a flood berm. You know, a lot of the work that I'm going to reference Waterfront Toronto. So Toronto's waterfront has been building, was all in a floodplain. So the first step that they're doing before they start building there is transforming all the park space to be berms and water ponds. And those themselves both perform as a piece of infrastructure because they're protecting the neighborhood from flooding, but they themselves are recreational spaces when they're not flooded. So they're designed proactively. It's not something where you're waiting for a place to become so inhabitable that it becomes, you know, a bad part of the city or something that is left over, but it's something that is proactively designed to deal with flooding, not as a worst case scenario, but as a sort of everyday thing. You live with it. It's just there, and the urban fabric and all of its infrastructure is built in relation to it. I don't know if that answers your question exactly, but I would say one of the main things is that we shouldn't wait until the next flood to say, you know, what do we do with all these properties and this entire riverfront? We should start to act and build our park space and open space to know that it is responsive, and then our buildings will be built in relation to that.
Thank you. And I think that will be you're going to be our last question.
Gosh, I hope it's a good one. It seems today there's a bit of a siege on truth and fact.
That's a good question.
And so with these very elegant visualizations, do you encounter blowback or hostility, and how do you counteract that sort of thing to get your message across and to make the right decisions?
I'll jump in on that. It depends who you're showing the image to. Okay. From the public, I found typically that the public is very receptive to beautiful images, as was mentioned. And it's a way for them to, so, and by the public, I mean, I should just qualify that. People who aren't trained visually, but just, you know, who, I often find that that architects can be very skeptical because they think you're trying to seduce them, and engineers as well. They think you're trying to seduce them with a beautiful image, and sometimes you are. So, but they do it too. So it's fair. Actually, where we've had the most pushback is on the digital fabrication that I showed tonight. Where at one event, someone stood up in the crowd and said, "Carlton, take your computers and go home. We've been cutting stone for 1,000 years. We don't need you." So, as I say, I guess I'm saying that also to qualify. It depends, because it depends whose button you push. If you show a beautiful image to someone who makes beautiful images, they're suspicious of it. If you show a machine that can do something that a person can do, they're suspicious of it. So, I hope that
unless helps it's answer. Making your drinks. And then they just love it.
I would say, to what purpose, right? So there's a million, I was trying to just quickly show in one slide that there's a million websites that show, where's the person who asked the question? Oh, yeah. A million kind of applications where you put a like slider bar and it shows you like 1 foot of flooding, what it would happen to. Like, there's a lot of different ways in which visualization is trying to show you the negative detriments of an existing condition. And I would say, if sometimes the tool is trying to show you what you could do with it, right? So part of the platform is that if you combine certain parameters with each other, this might be a zone in which you might, you know, transfer density. This is a zone where you should turn into park. Like, as soon as you start offering alternatives or ideas that are sort of built in, the truth is not that you're trying to show the kind of simply the vulnerability or risk by itself, but trying to say, here's opportunities. There's potentials in how this might be transformed. If there's a positive, I would say, if there's a positive projective element to what you're trying to visualize, rather than always just a sort of negative detriments, then there's a chance that this material might be received differently, right? So the people in Florida, again, have seen their houses flooded, like, you know, visualized as flooded places over and over and over again. But I feel like my role as a designer is to offer them an alternative, a projective one, but not based on my personal opinion, but based on series of parameters that generate scenarios, and then those scenarios are visualized in a way where the public has a chance to react, not to a singular top-down zoning map that says you are now high density, but rather than there's a series of parameters that tell you why you are high density, and then they generate a bunch of scenarios in which you can envision what it's like to live in this context. So again, I feel like the projective element is the thing that should tag on to the truth rather than something, you know, just the existing state by itself.
Well, obviously we prefer when our glossy images of the future are well received. They're not always well received, but we really don't see that as a failure. The point for us is to get a reaction, be it good or bad, so we can understand collectively if this image of the city of tomorrow is consistent with what people really want. So we see this imaging process as really important to start to have that conversation, because without, to the untrained eye, often maps or architectural drawings are very difficult to make it tangible. But we've had a lot of success with these glossy renderings that sometimes are called propaganda, but we've had a lot of success in getting a reaction out of people when we start to visualize from the human eye's perspective how these future scenarios could play out. So obviously we want people to love and believe, but also just to have a debate about it to lend us their opinions.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming out. Merci d'être venu ce soir. Yes, a round of applause for all of our speakers. And please consult the Azrieli School website for the next event and the NCC Urbanism Lab for our next event starting in 2018. Thank you, merci et bonsoir. Hey, look at the camera, everybody.